Dr. Freda Medina. I'm the technical market manager for BASF Professional Specialty Solutions. I'm super excited to be here today because we want to have our second Perimeter Pro seminar series will be presented by Dr. Jason Myers. He's going to be talking about a couple of topics very important for perimeter pest control. And one of them is mosquitoes and also ants. Today, I want also to introduce the Perimeter Pro Callback Challenge, and I'll go in details on what that that means and what's in there for you. But before, I want to remind you a couple of things. As a bonus, we're gonna, thank you for joining us today. We're gonna do a drawing where we're gonna have some random prizes, and what we're gonna do is the first winner is gonna have a backpack sprayer, and the second and third, we're gonna have some Yeti tumblers as prizes. So when we talk about the callback challenge and we talk about Perimeter Pro, so let's jump real quick and see what it means exactly. So when we look at, let's see if it works. Okay, slow, it's not moving to the next slide here. Okay, there you go. So when we look at our Perimeter Pro playbook and specifically about our Perimeter Pro seminar series and program, we have what we call the keys to the game. And you will learn these keys, but I wanna point out that this includes a commitment, our commitment to an IPM strategy and choosing the right rotation of product rotation, building a strong bullpen with trusted products for those tough situations and tough accounts. When we look at IPM strategy, we always recommend starting with a thorough inspection. Make sure you're using exclusion strategies to deny pest access to the home, right? We need to address those habitats and microhabitats where pests are hiding and use physical and mechanical, not only control. Remember, control is only one piece of the puzzle. So choosing the right product rotation is very important. And you're gonna have your star players. These are the go-to products that you normally use around the perimeter of the structure and based on pest pressure, seasonality, and things like that. But also you have to make sure you rotate those based on their mode of action. You have to tailor your plan to reflect your service frequency. As you already know, it's not the same doing quarterly service, bi-monthly or monthly services. So you have to adjust to that. And be ready when we're talking about those trusted specialist products for tough situations, make sure you're ready to use these in your portfolio. Make sure that you choose the right product. How easy or how difficult it is to use is also important, knowing the label, where to use it and when to use it. And most importantly is knowing when you're ready to make a decision, a switch on these product selection that fits your needs or your customers' needs. So when we look at the starting rotation, we looked at the dilutables. Dilutables are our go-to products for the most part when we talk about Perimeter Pro and Perimeter Pest Control. Thermidor SC being your foundation. Foundation meaning that it's a product that because of the limitations on the label allows you to use it only twice a year for ant control and limitation on where you can apply it. But very few people know that you can use Thermidor SC for spider control. It's one of the greatest products we have for spider control and for wasp control as well. So there's a whole list of general insect control on the label that you can take a look at. Then when you look at Alpine WC water soluble insecticide, granular insecticide, it offers a very flexible label. It's really powerful on ants. It's actually a great complement to Thermidor because they're both non-repellents and in a way they both have transfer effect, not so much as we do for Thermidor SC, but Alpine also has those properties as well. Then when you look at Fendona CS control release insecticide, you have a long lasting broad spectrum microencapsulated perimeter treatment choice here. And of course we have our newest innovation Redesco WG insecticide, easy to mix formulation similar to Alpine WG with two mode of action. And actually it's a great complement of when we're dealing with resistance, avoiding insecticide resistance and all that. So when you look at the right-hand side, you have the bullpen. These are your specialist products. You want these to be the top quality products. You want these to be easy to use, ready to use type of products. I'm not going to discuss any of these that you see here on the list, but you have the idea. You're going to be able to learn about this product through the series and these seminar series. Now, when we look at the callback challenge, why we wanted to introduce this, we are all aware of the downside of the callbacks, and not only financial cost, missed opportunity, higher labor cost, and things like that, but also customer dissatisfaction, poor customer reviews, negative impacts of reputation, loss of referrals, also loss of time, business disruption. How many techs love getting that call at 3 p.m. in the afternoon and say you have to go to the opposite side of town to take care of a problem that wasn't solved on to begin with on the first place? So longer working hours, more driving time, you name it, there's a lot of trouble and problems associated with these. So to join the challenge, we're going to be sending an online assessment to evaluate your current practices. And you're going to be scored on those depending on your answers there. We're going to get in details a little bit on that. But the whole idea is to incorporate those Perimeter Pro keys to the game. Make sure through all these seminars you're going to be listening to in the next, all this year, in the next few minutes, and mostly today, you're going to be walking through all these keys to the game, and make sure that you take the assessment again later on this year. That would allow you to compare to what we did before and after, and it will allow you to really analyze how the changes you made actually made a difference on those callback rates. Again, you will be receiving an email tomorrow, and it will contain a link to the webinar. It's going to contain also a link to the cost of callbacks video that you saw on the previous slide on the picture. And you're going to get a link to the self-assessment. I have some pictures here of that self-assessment questions. And there's going to be prize winners, of course, that will be drawn at the end. The other thing I do want to mention is the self-assessment questions. They are very easy to answer. These are drag and drop type of questions. And some of these are just check boxes that you will be able to answer in only a few minutes. So I highly encourage you guys to watch the video that is going to come along and click on those assessment questionnaire that you'll be able to fill out. With that being said, remember that we'll be answering some of these questions at the end of the webinar, and make sure you click on the Q&A box and I'll get to those questions. We'll post the question and we'll be able to get to those, but only at the end. So with that, I'm just gonna move over to Dr. Jason Myers. He will be presenting on mosquitoes and on ants today. Thank you.
Excellent, thank you, Fredder. I hope everybody is doing very well today. As Fredder has noted, we're gonna be talking about both mosquitoes and ants. And hopefully we're going to be giving you some new pieces of information. We'll go from some of the basics in regards to mosquitoes and their associated behavior and how we can utilize our products in a better manner to more efficiently create applications and to also reduce our callbacks. And then we move to ants. We're going to be discussing again a few of the basics, but not too much. And then we'll move into some concepts that you may not have thought of before in regards to your ant program. We kind of want to invite you to rethink how to effectively figure out whether or not your ant program is working for your business, and see how you can or cannot produce a little bit more profit for your company, especially in regards to ant control and your ant program. So with that, we'll get started with mosquitoes. Mosquitoes can be found in a wide variety of areas within the habitat of, say, a backyard residence or even in a commercial setting. Such a wide variety of areas in which The adult female mosquitoes can alight or land on a given surface throughout their life cycle. And then all these different areas in which they might be ovipositing. And that might be ovipositing and creating populations in neighboring yards that give greater problems to your customer. And if that is the case, we also need to discuss some educational wherewithal within our homeowners so that they understand the mitigating circumstances around some of the potential bites that they might be having. Mosquitoes don't have to land in the area in which we are treating them. And so we'll kind of get into that here in a little bit. Some of the biggest reasons for callbacks on mosquito programs is it tends to flow around a few different concepts. One of the biggest ones is education, understanding what the products are capable of doing and what they're not capable of doing, adherence to the labels and what they're capable of doing and what they're not capable of doing, all right? So legalities and regulations associated with those. Obviously, homeowners have a tendency for great amounts of clutter. These can be yardening tools and even like in my backyard, a bunch of toys for the kids that might sit around for too long. All of these can create situations for greater populations in regards to different mosquito species and their associated behaviors. House washing is a really big issue. Conveying that piece of information to homeowners and making sure that they are not going to be washing their house right after you have done an application, especially if you have done applications on structure and even away from structures, say on the backs of sheds and the like. Adulticide resistance is quite prevalent throughout the United States, especially in the South, but it has been spread throughout the United States. Excuse me. And then some of the painting that is done on structures. If it is new, it can really basically hold on to different types of insecticides. And what happens is as they age, they will reduce their ability, the paint's ability to hold on to insecticides. So if you're treating on a fairly new, a newly painted surface, that can greatly disadvantage you in regards to eliminating a potential landing adult female mosquitoes. Excuse me. All right, so there are a wide variety of different habitats in which ovipositions can occur. We see a wide variety of here. Most of these surround instantaneous flooding type situations. Most of these are container type areas in which very small spaces can create oviposition sites for adult female mosquitoes. You can see here even even certain plant types, the way that they're shaped, can elucidate some oviposition sites and even tree holes. In fact, I was just out doing an inspection on the outside of a house and noticed that one tree alone had three different potential tree holes or oviposition sites within that single tree. So it's quite problematic. And it, just a certain bit of education can really help out the homeowner and their expectations as well. Other species will behaviorally oviposition or oviposit in these kind of transient areas in which some of them typically are larger quantities or larger volumes. And these tend to be almost cyclical in nature. And that they're not always around, but whenever you get good amounts of rain and they stay for a good while. And that those types of behaviors will elucidate depending on the species and the area you are within within the country. Where are the adults going to typically land? They're gonna land in completely different scenarios. You think of it as during the day and then during rainy periods. And these are the two periods in which we want to capture them and their behaviors. All right. So during the day and during the daylight, when a fair amount of these species that are associated with backyards are going to be looking for a food source, they're going to be attracted to CO2 and to heat. And once they zero in, they're going to be zeroing in on individual people. And we'll kind of get into that and the reasoning why here in a minute. But in those particular areas, they're going to be staying nearby where humans or companion animals are going to be around in given areas. So under trees, shrubs, these overhang areas. Overhang areas are really important after adult mosquitoes have initially emerged from their pupal state. They really like to land in those north-facing areas that are nice and cool and shaded. And those are areas that we really also want to pay attention to so that we eliminate them before they become a problem. Under decks, my neighbor's got some really problematic areas because he's got a very large deck, and that could become a real genuine site for tremendous overposition areas. During rain events, they're going to completely change their behavior and they're going to look for hiding places, right? So looking at under tree bark, the undersides of leaves, which is why when we are applying with gas-powered application devices, we can really start to blow into certain areas and certain shrubs that might prevent us if we're only using certain types of machinery, like a simple pump and spray B&G and the like, all right? So we're gonna be able to get material much farther back into these areas if we're using the proper equipment type. And when we shake these leaves, we're hitting all the different sides of the surfaces, including the areas in which the behavior is going to elicit, they are going to elicit when raining events occur. And it's also a good spot to place a product because it is a little bit more protected than it is from when it gets rained on directly, okay? And then we also want to think about siting and eaves again. Eaves, I can't stress it enough, is a big key to preventing mosquito bites. All right, so we've long had the questions surrounding why do mosquitoes generally bite me? Now, first of all, we could potentially react more than other people, right? It might be in our system, in our immune system, to react to certain types of bites more than other people, okay? So that's first off. It's kind of like bed bugs. Half the people react, half the people don't, okay? But there are other reasons why mosquitoes are generally attracted to certain people more than others. Basically, you can think about them as stink compounds, right? You put out the right kind of stink and they are going to be more attracted to certain individuals. Some people put out more CO2 than others, so it's going to potentially zero them in to those individuals. Also, if you have just finished working out, they're going to be attracted to higher concentrations of lactic acid. Be mindful of that. Additionally, if you're wearing the wrong type of fragrance, the wrong deodorant, they might be more attracted to those types of perfumes than they are to others. You take my family, for instance, we are all totally different. My wife and daughter get absolutely nailed by 80s species in our yard. But later in the season, when the culex start to come out, me and the boys get attacked like crazy. It's just certain certain species will elicit different types of behaviors, and they are seeking different types of, frankly, a blood type, right? And so there are a number of different reasons for this, at any rate, all of it is chemical related. All right, so DEET, when we're out this summer and we're thinking about repelling mosquitoes when we're on the lake or something, someplace similar, there are a couple of different theories as to how DEET actually functions, all right? They are both repellency and as a confusant. And they're both pretty solid theories. The repellency basically shows that the DEET becomes a very sensitive odor and that mosquitoes avoid passing through what they call a curtain, a kind of like a chemical curtain, if you will. Okay, so they can become repelled by it. The other theory is as a confusant, in that DEET basically masks your smell and they can't really sense you. They know you're around, but they can't zero in on you because of the DEET. Either way, DEET works. And it's one of the only compounds out there that has consistently worked throughout time and throughout all sorts of different studies. The only other compound that I am aware of that comes close to DEET's ability is lemongrass oil. And some of those studies have demonstrated that it shows a pretty high repellency rate. The problem with the lemongrass oil is it does cause a burning sensation, especially if you accidentally get it in some of your facial areas. It can really sting you. I know I've tried it, and it, you know, if I accidentally somehow get it onto my lips, it really stings quite a bit. So some people have some pretty sensitive reactions to different types of oils, but lemongrass seems to be the one that causes the greatest amount of repellency or confusing type of behaviors. All right, so the other thing to keep in mind as far as behavior, depending on species, mosquitoes can and will fly very long distances depending upon the species. All right, when we think about Aedes species, which is probably the number one group of species as far as a nuisance species, and frankly, disease-associated group of species, we need to really pay close attention to the fact that they are only typically flying up to a quarter of a mile. More often than not, they're going to go from neighbor to neighbor seeking some sort of host. So they typically are sticking around a particular neighborhood. So the cleaner your neighbors are, the more likely you are to potentially prevent those types of behaviors. But reconcile that. Mosquitoes, certain types of species, can and will fly very long distances in order to seek hosts and new oviposition sites. All right, so here is something that a lot of people are not generally aware of. When we have certain moon phases, meaning the full moon and gibbous cycles, we can actually vastly increase mosquito behavior. All right. The question is how much? And it is very significant. In these full moon phases, the mosquito behavior can actually increase by 500%. So if you're getting callbacks around these times, guess what? You might be able to blame the moon. So you can also potentially set certain expectations for your customers that you may end up with increased biting behavior from mosquitoes that might not be landing in the treated areas in which you applied material because they're coming over from three neighbors down or something. But they are very ravenous during these full moon periods. All right, so the future of mosquito control, where are we going and what do we potentially foresee? You can expect to have a pretty fair amount of increased resistance to different strains, different species, but since it is pretty prevalent throughout the United States, you can expect that these types of resistance issues are going to increase, okay? And don't mix resistance with repellency, okay? Certain products are going to elicit repellency. Some of them are not, okay? But resistance will become an increased issue as we move along throughout the years. I would expect more Zika outbreaks. The United States has not done a very good job of looking for Zika. not exactly very aggressive with their discernment on where Zika actually is within the United States. They've looked at pockets in Florida, but not quite heavily. So I would expect additional Zika scares if somebody starts to look into some of these certain areas. We are going to have more mosquito-borne diseases that are going to come out of the tropics. It is going to happen. Zika was one of those examples. It's been, you know, deep in the Congo for quite a while. We've known about it for 70 years, and then suddenly it pops up. So at some point, we are going to have some other mosquito-borne disease breakout. What that is, who knows? There are going to be new products, probably not very many. EPA is pretty stringent on the applications for mosquito products and the potential exposure related to those. So don't expect too many products. Maybe you'll end up with new formulations and the like, but not too many new active ingredients, okay? Hold on to the ones you've got and take care of them. Take care of them very well. drone pesticide applications have increased very significantly within mosquito control area districts. I would expect that to continue and maybe even ramp up significantly so. And I don't know how well it's going to parlay into our industry, but it wouldn't surprise me to see a few companies trying it out fairly soon. All right, so let's march into some of the studies that we've been working on. First off, I want to start off with global mosquito control and discuss those areas. All right, so many of you obviously know about malaria. Malaria is a very significant issue throughout Africa and Southeast Asia. You know, we talk about COVID quite a bit and the mortality of human beings associated with COVID, and we know how few children are killed from COVID relative to malaria, where, you know, you're looking at 4 out of 5 people that die from malaria are children. So it is a very significant factor throughout the world, like I said, primarily in Africa and Southeast Asia. And we have been increasing a lot of our testing and products in those areas. And to that end, we actually have a new net, and it is called Interceptor G2. It's the second version of the original Interceptor. And this is termed basically a filament net in which the active ingredient is impregnated, but it does not necessarily have to stay impregnated into it. It's the only net on the market, the long-lasting net, that actually has two different active ingredients that work very much in concert with one another. Both of them are ones that you are familiar with, an alpha-cypermethrin and chlorfenapyr, found in Fendona and Phantom, respectively. And what's unique about this particular netting is that they can actually wash the material up to 20 times, and it still elicits the same or very similar types of mortality associated with it. And whenever it gets washed, the active ingredient, and I'll show you the picture here in a minute, the crystals can actually go back into and recess into the filament material so that it resists the washing events, all right? And it kills metabolic resistant mosquitoes very readily. And that's due to the combination of those two different AIs, which, like I said, work in concert with one another. Here's a picture of the crystals of the active within the net and actually on the net at this point in time. And here are some of the results. You could see if we only use one particular active ingredient in the green box, we elicit some very mundane control efforts. But if we add in the additional active ingredient, we actually increase vastly the amount of kill associated with it. And there are many, many different types of mosquito nets on the market in Africa and Southeast Asia that just simply do not compare to these level of results. Typically, we think of 100% as something good, and they're looking at 75% as something that is excellent. These are some very difficult environments. So know that we are working on all sorts of different technologies throughout the world, and a lot of those technologies get pulled into the things that we work on here in the US. So let's move over to the United States mosquito control data. One of the things that we don't often think about is the data associated with human beings and how some of these products are affecting people, and specifically the people that are applying the product. So one of the questions we end up getting is, what is paresthesia? Paresthesia is simply a poor reaction to a substance. In this case, we're talking about an insecticide to your skin. And in our case, what is typically felt from different types of pyrethroids is a slight burning sensation, okay? Not everybody reacts this way, but some people can react in a very negative fashion. And in some cases, I've known of some people breaking out in actual boils from certain products. So it's something that is very real, and it is a significant concern, especially of those technicians that are utilizing the material and having a potential exposure, especially on their arms. Fendona CS has a particular cap size and consistency in the capping process, in that we believe that almost, if not 100% of it, is actually capped material. So there's no free floating active ingredient in order to elicit those types of reactions. So keep that in mind. We don't always want to talk about data about the mosquito. We want to talk about data associated with human beings and how we can create a safer environment for the applicators. All right, on to some semi-field exercises. This particular project, we did a half field, half laboratory exercise, in which we actually applied a couple of different products, including Fendona, at high rates. And if you're keeping track of mixing per gallon, these are 3/4 ounce of the competitive product and 2 ounces per gallon within the Fendona. Within this trial, we treated these particular plants, the bougainvilleas, with either of these products. And then we allowed it to rain 1/4 inch every week through fake rain environments, what is captured here in these particular photos. And you can see the amount of rain throughout the process of this particular setup. This was done in New Mexico, so it's a very dry environment, which is a very unfriendly environment for caps. Any sort of dry environment typically tends to be a very negative environment for caps. So this is basically testing it to the nth degree in these types of setups. Once the leaves were treated and aged for whatever amount of time, they were taken and placed into a cup that had a fine mesh on the top, and then the mosquitoes were placed inside of that. And then, of course, the mortality was tracked afterwards. And you can see that none of the mosquitoes had to land on the leaf surface, but yet you'll notice that most of these, 100%, were killed during certain segments of time post-application. And here we start to see some of the results. These are the results of the common malaria mosquito, or the Anopheles mosquito group. And we notice here Fendona having 100% control out to 21 days, which is in many ways the industry standard for the length of period between applications. If you want to start stretching those out to further applications, you can probably move those out potentially somewhat significantly, maybe a week, 2 weeks, maybe even 4 weeks in some situations. But you notice out here at 2 months out, we start to have a significant difference or separation from 100% control. And you notice that the other competitive material is dropping off and reducing its efficacy compared to that of Fendona. And then on out to 90 days, and there's still some fairly significant activity and mortality associated with it. Now we look at the yellow fever mosquito, a nice day biter, and we get really nice results out to 21 days, and it starts to depreciate out at 2 months, but we're still at 90% control out at those 2 month period for Fendona. And then on out to 90 days, we still have some fairly significant control. The southern house mosquito, we get again 100% out to 21 days, and then plus 90% at the 60 day period, okay? So these materials are working, or Fendona is working very significantly on out into the 2 month period. So attempting to stretch that and attempting to save money while still satisfying the customer needs is something of consideration, especially depending on your area of the country. Another trial that we did is trying to take a look at the caps themselves on plant material, which is the most important material relative to mosquito control. And so this was done down at Texas A&M University with a scanning electron microscope. And you can see here on the blanket flower, which has a lot of undulations associated with it, if you're familiar with this particular plant. And you can see the caps being placed onto the plant with a BNG. And you notice that the caps take up a tremendous amount of surface. And good luck to any sort of mosquito or any other pest insect that is attempting to navigate those particular areas. You're going to be hard pressed not to expose yourself to one or many different caps within the stepping on that surface, okay? So furthermore, speaking of rain fastness, which we more or less brought up earlier, there is tremendous resistance to wash off because of the alpha cypermethrin. At that point, the insolubility of the alpha cypermethrin really negates it as a water issue and more of a sunlight issue. Okay, so sunlight is not friendly. Photolysis is not friendly to very many insecticides at all, let alone pyrethroids, but it is a considerable concern for the tops of leaves and lesser so for the bottom sides of leaves. But alpha cypermethrin has excellent stability on the plant tissue itself, primarily because of the waxy material or the waxy surface that is on the insect. And that is greatly, has great similarity to that of insects. So as an insect moves along, there's just as much likelihood of it to move off of the plant material and onto the insecticide. All right. All right, eggs. We're not making omelets every day, but hopefully we will eliminate mosquito eggs. All right. So if we think of eggs as another potential avenue for control, we take a look at this particular container. And with all these black specks, you notice that the 80 species has been ovipositing onto this cup, basically hoping that this cup would fill up with water and the eggs would then be able to hatch over time. All right, so kind of like a miniature flood. All right, so what do we take a look at? We looked at Fendona and the use within basically fake buckets, if you will, right? On these, The mosquito eggs were laid on the surface, and they were artificially glued to the surface, and then the Fendona was sprayed onto the surface of the bucket, also potentially hitting the eggs themselves. And then we looked at the emergence of the eggs or lack thereof afterwards. So we look at the results 1 hour after treatment, and we notice that the untreated controls larvae emerge quite readily, and you see no blue bars whatsoever with the Fendona CS treatments. 1 week out, we wait another week. Maybe we've missed a few, but we have not. Again, none of the larvae have emerged from the egg state. All right. Again, the untreated controls, quite a few of them had emerged from the eggs themselves. All right. And so if you have gathered up any questions on the mosquitoes, please kind of save those or put those into the Q&A function. Fredder will keep track of those. And then we will get to those questions at the end of the talk after we're done discussing ants, okay? All right, as you heard me discuss earlier, we're going to talk about ants, their biology, how we can take advantage of their behavior, and then also how we can take some of the more typically known pieces of research and apply it in a business sense to our ant program and see if we can't reduce some of the profit loss associated with ant callbacks. All right. First off, we're going to go with the state of the market. As you may or may not have noted last year in the PCT articles on a variety of different subject matters, but again, ants came out on top as the one of the largest sources for revenue. Again, I don't expect this to change anytime soon. Ants are very well adept to humanity and living in association with them. So I don't expect this to have any great movement, even though rodents have been increasing quite readily here of late. I don't expect them to overtake ants anytime soon. most of you have noted, and this has remained pretty true over the last decade, a pretty significant growth in the business. Specific to ants is something that we're going to kind of start to take a look at. All right, carpenter ants. Carpenter ants are still the number one pest overall, primarily in the Northwest and the Northeast, being the most significant in regards to economic damage. And we notice here that 80% of everybody, of all of you, considered them the most problematic, or at least problematic in the generalized sense. And one out of five said that it made up their largest percentage of service calls, okay? So a pretty significant pest, still probably the number one pest. Coming on very strong the last 5 years or so, it seems, is odorous house ant. Odorous house ant has had a very significant increase and is now really covering pretty much all of the United States with an exception of a few areas here and there. But for the most part, odorous house ant has increased massively. 63% of PMPs considered it problematic, and 24% of them said it was the largest percentage of their service calls. All right. If you were to have asked that 3 years ago, those numbers are definitely not the same. Both of those numbers have increased pretty rapidly. Pavement ants. Pavement ants have remained very steady. It does seem, at least in my mind, the greater amount of larger buildings, the more apt we are to have pavement ant issues. Obviously, the more sidewalks that are built around residential areas, the more problematic they tend to be. But for the most part, pavement ant is holding pretty steady. but it's pretty low in regards to the largest percentage of service calls at 8%. Argentinians, remaining fairly steady. It does increase. Only a third of PMPs say it's problematic, but it might actually be the highest percentage of largest revenue generator relative to those that considered it problematic. So if you do have Argentine ants, it is a very significant issue, or tends to be, all right? And mostly that is owed to the fact that it is a very large population insect. For those of you with tawny crazy ants, you can feel that pain quite considerably, and some of you have both, which is interesting predicament to have. All right, so what did they find as far as seasonal differentiation? Probably the biggest surprise in this is that splitting summer into two different quadrants kind of roughly gives you the greatest amount of physical effort being in the first half of the summer compared to that of all of spring at 33% for the busiest time of year. For those of you typically in the South and Midwest. And then there are some in the late summer, and then of course they fall off to nearly nothing in the fall and winter and just have various problematic issues. All right. Now here's one that we want to kind of concentrate on, and which is going to more or less parlay into the remainder of the talk, is callback rate. The average callback rate throughout the country is roughly 6%, give or take, depending on your neck of the woods, all right? If you are anywhere over 1%, I am telling you, you can reduce that callback and potentially very significantly. These callbacks are costing the company quite a bit of money, and we'll get into that calculation here in a little bit. But first off, I want to set it up with behavior and the behaviors that are most associated with the issues in regards to callbacks and why that is. Ant behavior is coming directly from their biology. What are they potentially capable of in a given environment? So the question is, how do we take advantage of that type of behavior? And there are some nice little keys that we can utilize. This particular study is probably the most important study that has maybe possibly ever been done in regards to ant control. And it was not conducted by an entomologist. Dr. Dornhaus took a look at the behaviors of an ant colony. And what they did is they observed the ants in an arena and figured out which ants were doing what type of behaviors. And as you can see, some of them are multicolored, all right? So whenever they did a particular type of behavior, they colored them that particular color. So if they're foraging or they're taking care of the brood, the larvae, or they're taking care of the eggs, or they're taking care of the queen, or they're guarding the nest, being soldier-like, any number of different types of behaviors. And what they did was they took one particular color out of the colony, and then they observed how the colony reacted to that. And when they did that, they started to observe the efficiency of ants. And when they removed that particular color from the colony, the other individual stepped up. Even though they hadn't been doing that behavior at all, and they did the job just as efficiently and quickly as the previous ants that were doing that type of behavior. So those other ants had all the experience, but innately, these other ants were totally capable of doing the same type of job just as efficiently. Now the question is, why is that terribly important to why we end up with so many callbacks? And that is because our colonies consist of anywhere from 2 to 10% of a colony that is foraging. It depends on the species, okay? And if the only thing that we're going after are the foragers, then guess what? We have a colony that may very well just be sitting there waiting and biding its time to come back onto the property for whatever reason, whether accidental-like or because they're repelled by a particular type of product, but they might just be simply waiting to go back onto that property and cause a callback 2 weeks later, 4 weeks later, 8 weeks later, who knows? But control of the population is what we need to really be seeking. So how can part of this be the issue, all right? Why are foraging ants the issue if we're only treating foraging ants? Part of the answer is actually contained here in Stoy Hedges' PCT book on ants, in which it discusses the use of pyrethroids. And here it says, end quote, perimeter treatment using pyrethroid insecticides can complicate ant management programs. And it goes on further. Pyrethroid insecticides can vary in their repellency to ants, and parts of ant colonies can thus be cut off from the rest of the colony outside. And where have we heard that before? We've heard that in regards to termite behaviors and associated with pyrethroid applications and closing in from the outside and pushing termites to the interior of a structure. It's the opposite of what we want to do. We could potentially end up causing more problems than what we had. Now, do pyrethroids work most of the time? They certainly do, okay? Statistics will bear that out. The question is, how do we get from most of the time down to 100% of the time? And that's the key, all right? So we start to take a look at some of the behaviors that we can start to take advantage of. And one of them is actually regards to a morphological structure that we see here on this particular photo right here. And if I highlight this spot right here, which is the antennal comb. And so this antennal comb is used to comb the antenna, all right? They need to clean their antennae. Their antennae are incredibly sensitive and they need to keep that sucker clean so that they can prevent any sort of physical contaminants onto the antennae so that they can tell each other through chemical means, hey, I'm hungry, or hey, we've got an enemy at the gates, we need to take care of them. Whatever type of communication that they're utilizing, they need to be able to communicate through their antennae. And we can see that type of behavior here on this particular video. And you notice that the one on the left is already combing the antenna. And it's combing it with that little antennal comb device that is found near the end of the leg, all right? And when we start thinking about the potential of insecticides transferring from the feet of an ant onto the body parts of the ant, this is a major route that we can take advantage of. Okay, so all sorts of type of behaviors can get associated with this. They move it up to the antennae. You just saw this ant go and touch the other ant, right? What are some of the other behaviors we're looking at? You could be doing incidental contact, which we can see here with tawny crazy ant, where they're moving quite readily over one another and touching each other like crazy. The opportunities for transfer of an insecticide is rampant in these situations. The higher the population of ants, the more likely you are to elicit transfer. But you can also spread a product too thin too. So some active ingredients are fully capable of doing these types of behaviors, but if their populations are too high, that means the insecticide is less likely to be able to do its job. So picking out the right type of insecticide is absolutely paramount to having consistent control of all sorts of different ant populations throughout the year and throughout the regions of the United States. All right. So let's take a look real quickly at the transfer studies. We see here on this particular lab study that looked at both Terminator and Alpine. Everybody's always been aware of the capabilities of Terminator and the ability of it to cause transfer mortality in association with it. But in here, we take a look at Alpine specifically associated with this. In this case, we're looking at tawny crazian. And here, they actually allow a donor-recipient ratio of 5 to 50. So we have 5 treated individuals that are then placed into 50 untreated individuals. All right, so that comprises basically 10% of a population, right? Much akin to the foragers that we talked about earlier, being anywhere from 2 to 10% of a colony. And then we could see the mortality that's associated with both of these products. They're very similar, okay? And very little control mortality that you can see in green. In blue, we see here with the Alpine WSG, mortality associated with that. Within 3 days, you're looking at pretty much 100% control, very comparable to the Terminator application. And then the question comes, well, what if we start combining some of these various transfer studies that we've looked at? What are they going to look like? And when we start to combine these donor recipient transfer studies, we start to kind of see a much bigger picture here. Again, in this case, we were looking at carpenter ants. And a different way of looking at this is that we are spraying these donor workers. We're taking their donor workers anywhere from 2 to 10% of a colony and pushing them over to untreated workers, just like we did before. In this case, we're looking at both 1 or 5. So a very minimal dosing, if you will, of a population. All right. And this very accurately represents, when, especially when we use live workers, it represents what you would actually be doing when you're out in the field. Okay. All right. There goes the fancy animation. And we see the results here specific to Alpine WSG. So when we're looking at in the darker color, 1 to 50 ratio, or 2% of a population, or 5 to 50, which is like 10% of a population. And then you look at controls, there were no deaths associated with that. But you see very similar mortality curve here in association with Alpine WSG. Okay, so there is some sort of transfer occurring here that is causing more significant mortality within these particular populations. Okay, so what if we combine this with the original Terminator transfer study that was done some years ago? This is the study, the very first one of its kind that Dr. Hansen did more than, 20 years ago, I think, and looked at Terminator SC against bifenthrin, okay, so a pyrethroid. So in here, we're going to be able to see, does pyrethroid actually elicit some sort of transfer effect? And it'll cut to the chase, it does not. It doesn't do much of anything beyond what is found in control mortality. So we see here in this particular video, we see Dr. Hansen marking the individual arenas. But what she will do is she will take the dead insects that have died from either a Terminator application or a bifenthrin application, and then she'll place those individuals into the healthy populations and then observe that mortality over time. So a very a simplistic process. You can see here placing one individually dead worker from a particular treatment into a group of healthy individuals. And you will see that they will immediately go up to that dead individual and they will start to manipulate the individual. They'll check it out. Hey, Bessie, are you okay? Hey, you're not looking so hot, and then they're going to do something with it. But in the meantime, they're touching that ant all over the place. So whether it's bifenthrin or Termidor, they're going to have tremendous access to any potential transfer that might be occurring during that type of behavior. All right, so go back to what we just discussed and the mortality curve associated with that transfer test. And then we look at what the original data showed with Termidor, and you see almost an exact match to the mortality curve. In fact, you see a little bit better with Alpine on the front end of the 2% donor to recipient population. So when you overlay that, you really see how significantly similar these two products are in relation to control or potential control of a whole population. And we go back to this particular study and how greatly behavior begats the potential for field effects in ant control and whether or not you get consistent control of a population over time. And it is a tremendous key to this very behaviorally based research paper that was conducted. And I cannot stress how important it is and really elucidates and puts a shining light on why we have so many potential callbacks within our industry. And I really truly believe that we can eliminate a huge chunk of those types of callbacks and save companies quite a bit of money. So with that, I want to parlay that type of ant behavior and look at some of the field-based research and show how that can affect your business and your profit margins. So I want you to open your minds to the possibility of rethinking an ant program if you've not done so already and looking at it with a little bit of a fresh eye and see how it could potentially create a positive effect within your ant program. Okay, the first one is a field research study out of Purdue. In this case, we looked at Termidor up against some of the cheaper products on the market. And then we looked at what is done still quite often, which is every other month applications, in this case of both ants and spiders, all right? And then we looked at the effects of those. So not only did we keep track of the survival or the reduction in population field structures, but we kept track of the volume of use and then how much time it took to apply those volumes associated with each product. All right, first up, we see the results of two different applications. One was the first treatment done here on May 25th, the second treatment on July 24th. Okay, so 2 months apart. And right here, we look at the results 7 days after the first treatment, and then a day before the second treatment. Okay, and then the second treatment occurs, and then we look at 7 days after that second treatment, and then again, a day later, if you were gonna be doing another monthly application of some other product, okay? So we can see the overall reduction in control. And you can see here, Termidor is the most consistent of the bunch relative to both ants and spiders. And you heard Fredder mention earlier in the discussion, spiders, Termidor is an excellent product for spiders. And we just don't talk about it. It's really, you know, it's our fault, frankly, to not talk about it. But it's a very good spider product. So you look at the overall results here, and there's not much differentiation there, right? Yeah, you got more consistency with Termidor, but there's other ways to look at this. And that is to look at some of the volumes used. So first up, we looked at volume. Volume usage for Termidor was about 1 gallon on average for these particular structures. For Talstar and Suspend, it was right at about 3.5 gallons a piece, especially specifically in accordance with their label. And then the cost of application. Now the cost of application is gonna vary greatly within the region, within individuals. So, you know, take this part with a little bit of a grain of salt, There's not a tremendous amount of difference in this when you really type, look at this as far as the cost of application, but it does have a somewhat of an effect on the overall value that we're going to be talking about here in a few minutes. And then the amount of time it took for that application of these volumes to occur, okay? So the amount of time it took. And then the total cost, given that the average for say a callback is gonna cost you, run you $75 an hour. Again, it's gonna vary greatly upon the area in which you're at. This is a very conservative estimate because you know a lot of people are going to be using a nonprofit model for creating or figuring out what their callback costs are. So $75 an hour kind of seems about on average. So that's how much is costing the company for application time. So you can already see a pretty significant difference. Now, where we're going to start to change the dynamic is looking at what I call the business factor. So a brand new type of equation. We look at the total cost associated with the hourly wage. And then we look at what we call the business factor. And we take cost and we multiply that times the survival of the pest population. So whatever pest population we're looking at, in this case, it's both ants and spiders collectively. The lower the number, the more effective or efficient a product is, all right? So if you really want to think about survival being something that is tangibly counted that can predict the likelihood of a customer calling you back, survival is the best key. Now, some people, Mr. Smith over here, his threshold is, two ants. Over here, Mrs. Smith, her threshold is going to be 10 spiders or something, right? Everybody's going to have a different threshold. But if you look at an overall average, you're going to get a likelihood of a callback. And that is very specifically associated with the survival of the pests, or in this case, pests. All right. So you can see the equation, a fairly simple equation, but the lower the number, the more efficient a product is going to be. So let's take this and let's make an example out of it and make it nice and simple. Let's say we have an ideal product. It costs us a dollar. It costs us $9 to put out via labor or the amount of time it takes. So that equates to $10, all right? You have the surviving number of pests, whatever pest it might be, and you add that with the, or divide that out by the original population. Say you found 100 ants crawling around a structure, but the next time out after the application, you only found 10 ants, okay? That's your survival percentage, all right? So you divide that out and you get 10%. And then all you gotta do is simply multiply 10% or 0.1, multiply that times the $10 and you get your business factor of 1.0, okay? So let's take another example real quick. Let's say we have a product that's cheaper, but not as effective, right? It only costs us 50 cents. So half the price of the other product, right? Costs us the same amount of labor. So the cost is basically the same, $9.50. We saved on the front end. We didn't have to pay as much for the bottle, right? But it cost us a little bit on the surviving. Okay, we went from 10% to 25% survival, okay? And then we multiply those out and we get 2.4. So we've more than doubled our business factor exposure, right? So the likelihood of a callback occurring, it drastically increases, all right? So if we take again a look at what that business factor number was for this particular trial and the ants and spiders, Termidor is much more highly effective, even though it's more expensive than is both the Telstar and the Suspend applications. Okay, so let's take another example where we put this into a real world perspective. And this is ants only down in Puerto Rico. And we're looking at primarily crazy and ghost ants associated with these structures. We looked at Turbidor up against transport and temperate. And then this is the these are the rates that we were utilizing the products at, and then the area that was applied to, and the amount of volume per surface area that was applied, okay? So in these particular structures, the amount of gallonage is a little bit different. And I'll show you that here in a second, if I remember to put it in and show you kind of the difference here. Here were the results, okay? So you see some pretty fair similarities between a number of these products. You know, temperate kept up very nicely with Turbidor up to a point and then dropped off at about 8 weeks or, you know, roughly 2 months. Okay, but Turbidor maintained that control. Turbidor is a little bit higher than transport, right? Okay, so somewhat comparable to transport. And then you can see the control survival or reduction, okay? So the population kind of reduced over time, all right? Here's the average time to treat a particular home. On average, it took 4.5 times longer, roughly, thereabouts, to treat a structure if you're utilizing some of these other products. And that's because the volume is so much greater, okay? And we can see that volume difference here. We only used half of a gallon of Turbidor around these particular structures, but we used nearly 4 gallons of both temperate and transport. Now that's gonna significantly increase your cost per app. But really, when you think about it, that's not that much of an increase. Where your increase really comes home to roost is the amount of time for application and the fact that you used, you know, a whole lot more volume and you still didn't end up with as good a result, all right? So you drastically increase your amount of time associated with it, and then the labor really increases, okay? So if you look at the total cost of the product, where you add the cost of the product with the time for application or the labor associated with it, and you get your total cost. Then you find out your business factor, okay? Cost time survival. Turbidor SC, very low business factor. So the closer to zero, the better, more efficient the product is, and the decreased likelihood of getting a callback, all right? So tempered and transport, you know, quite a bit higher. Again, here are the here's the equation. So I hope this kind of gives you kind of a different perspective on how we can start to elucidate some of these field projects that we've been working on for, you know, years ago and didn't realize that, hey, you know what? We could correlate this with some real business outputs and maybe we could start saving some PMPs a lot of time and money, you know, get some of the technicians back home to their families quicker. And obviously we could start saving some profit. You know, we talk about all the time, quality of our industry and attracting new employees. You know, our industry is really having a hard time finding good employees. And if we can get them back to their families quicker during a day, just by simply saving on the amount of product that they're applying at a given structure, you know, if they save an hour or so per day or more, you know, maybe we can get them back. Or, you know, maybe if they're needing to make more, some more money, they can get out to some more structures on that given day. So you know, there's some big differences that we could make for our technicians, and maybe increase some of the positive factors within our industry to attract more people into it. So conclusions for both mosquitoes and ants, they provide tremendous perimeter challenges, whether that be weather associated with mosquito control or the ant behaviors themselves becoming tremendous challenges, just their populations alone. We need to always be keeping our ultimate or our eye on the ultimate prize, which is customer satisfaction, which leads to the potential for callbacks, helping to set those proper expectations for homeowners and managers at your customers so that they understand what the proper expectations are. Hey, we're not, you know, we might not get to zero with mosquitoes, but we're going to get darn close, you know. Pest behaviors greatly matter, especially with ants, and different types of insecticides will elucidate different types of behaviors, and that can greatly affect the bottom line of a business. And remember, cost of a bottle does not always equate to a success within the business, especially in regards to ant control. There is a tremendous avenue for increased revenue and increased family time for some of these products. It's not just chemical in the bottle, right? So with that, please follow all of those labels that we discussed, labels of law, and you know, it helps us out quite a bit too. So please be a good steward of our products. We try and, if you guys have any questions whatsoever on our labels, please, we're an open book. Come ask us. EPA and other state regulatory bodies come asking us all the time, what do we mean by this and what do we mean by that? So, don't fear a dialogue with both us and state regulatory folks. So with that said, I'd like to thank all of you for your attendance and your patience on waiting for the question and answer period. And with that, we will entertain any sort of questions you have. Fredder?
Yes, Jason, great talk today. So I do have a couple of few questions here. First one is, and I don't know if you know the answer to this, Jason, feel free to provide your feedback, but the first one is, what is the national average callback cost? I got a couple ideas, but go ahead and if you want to answer that.
I will let you put in on that answer as well, but I'm going to give you what I generally think is I asked a number of folks around the U.S. about what they thought might be a good callback number. And oddly enough, the first number we threw out was $75. Some of those calls take less time on average than the original call because maybe it's a spot application, but you've still got time associated with getting there and getting to your next job. And that's really the biggest cost. Not just, the minute cost of extra product, but it's really found in that labor. And I think it varies greatly depending on the type of business and how they structure their payment processing, whether they're hourly or on commission, as to, how significant those costs are. But I think 75 seems to be a pretty decent average. That can vary pretty significantly. What do you think, Fredder?
No, I'm with you. It depends on a lot of things, how you pay your technicians. It depends on what is your cost of your services. It's not the same being in New York City, but then being in somewhere else, a smaller town. So another way to look at this is it's all about timing. How long does it take you to do that call back? And try to figure out what kind of service can you perform in that time frame, and that how much do you charge for that time and for that type of service. So it gives you an idea that of how much that is going to cost you. And I agree, it could be anything between 75, 150, and even could go up to 100. More than 150 for sure. So it depends where you are. But yeah, you're right on. I do have a second question. I understand non-repellents were more effective than repellents like bifenthrin. So there's no question, but if you can elaborate, Jason, a little bit about the differences between repellents and and non-rebounds when it comes to effectiveness? Are we talking about ants? Are we talking about other insects, you know?
Sure, there's a, I view it as a couple of different major factors. One is the repellency factor. There's a number of different theories on how repellency actually comes about. And you kind of actually saw that in some of the definitions that we talked about in regards to DEET. Is it a repellent? Does it confuse? And so the same can be said within urban entomologists and what they theorize as to what repellency actually is. And so, you know, either way you look at non-repellents, like a majority of the perithroid group, you are effectively repelling a population, all right? Whether those individuals are dying almost immediately, and then the other ants can't continue the foraging trail because they die off too quickly and the remaining ants just don't know where to go, or are they physically repelled by the perithroid, which you can see sometimes in some videos and some behavioral observations. But then there's the other factor. Perithroids tend to adhere to the outside integument of the ants so acutely and so strongly that it does not pass from individual to individual. All right. Perithroids adhere really, really, really well to organic material. And ants are organic material. All right. But sometimes they bind too quickly or too strongly. And when they bind too strongly, they can't transfer from one individual to another. And really, the physical repellency of an application and then the lack of transfer, that combination, those two major factors is what I view as the biggest causation to the differences between the efficiency and efficacy of those two groups of insecticides.
All right, so we have another question here. Let me read it. Isn't it against a label to treat with Terminator more often than every 90 days? And just to give you some thoughts here, Jason, I think, remember that California has a 60-day requirement. And I don't know if this person is located, Christian Carver is located in California, but California has that restriction of 60 days.
Yeah, so within the Terminator label, for GIC applications now have the capability to use the potential of four different applications in a given year if you reduce down to 0.03%. Again, depending on where you're at in the country. If you're in California, you're further reduced to Fritter, what is it?
You could use it four rate times wise a year, but half the rate at 0.03. Yep. And but the restriction then that you have to wait 60 days in between treatments.
Yep. Yeah. And so in other areas of the country, you just can't combine those and, you've got to keep them within a calendar year, whatever calendar that starts on. So, you know, your initial treatment, say maybe March 1st or something like that, then you go to February 28th or whatever, into the next year, right? So so that particular, some states will look at it as a particular area that was actually physically treated or look at it as a whole as a site. And different regulatory bodies interpret that in different manners. And so that will be relative to each individual state. But that interpretation can vary pretty significantly based off of those two types of behaviors as well.
Okay, good. All right, next question is, I'm also working and watching. Can I get an email with this recording? Yes, I just wanted to remind everybody that you will be getting a recording of this presentation. That way you can watch it at your leisure. And that's coming tomorrow with that email, with the link, with assessment, and the winners as well. Remember, there will be prize winners announced tomorrow. So you will get all that information. The next question I have, I use Alpine for ants indoor, and I'm highly satisfied. However, I find spiders and smoky brown cockroach control to be poor. What do you suggest? Fendona is our millipede go-to product.
Did you say using Alpine or Fendona in the
I use Alpine for ants indoors, and I'm highly satisfied.
Got it.
However, I find spiders and smoky brown cockroach control to be poor. What do you suggest? Fendona is our millipede go-to product. So this is a person who likes Alpine, definitely, but having problem with spiders and smoky brown cockroach control.
Yeah, Fendona CS is, you know, that's our favorite product for spiders, especially indoors, obviously. We find it works quite well on a wide variety of different spiders. Fendona can also have an effect on smoky browns, but there also the possibility remains, depending on where they're at, the use of Phantom SC or aerosol, depending on where smoky browns are located. It's, you know, considerably good cockroach product. Has tremendous residual on some really oddball surfaces that are very tough, difficult to maintain residual on with other insecticides. So it kind of depends on the setups of those individual structures as far as the smoky brown applications.
Right. I got another question here on Fendona label. The mixing chart of 25-gallon tank is 2 to 4 fluid ounces. But in a 3-gallon spray tank, the mixing dilution is 3 to 6 ounces. Is there a reason I need to use more in a smaller tank than a larger tank?
So, the larger tank usage is typically what we, that is in the label really in regards to more maintenance type applications as opposed to a curative or even preventative. All right. So the larger gallonage and the reduced amount of product in those has actually been a pretty significant request from our customers. So we kept that in the label relative to what we used to similarly have with Sidekick CS, right? And so we kept that in there for those really intending to be maintenance type rates or even winter like applications.
All right. So looking at it, got another question here. If you do mosquito control to a yard and the neighbor has bushes along the property line, how much control can you achieve since you're not treating foliage very close to the yard? Did you?
So the bushes are not on the original or the customer's property, correct? Did I hear that right, Fredder?
So if you do mosquito control to a yard and the neighbor has bushes along the property line, so I'm assuming these bushes are on the property line.
Okay, yeah, I can read that side. Now.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So it depends. You could still treat turf as well. Turf is quite often a landing point for a variety of different mosquito species, and that turf, could end up resulting in some control. And it also depends on the other structural components on your customer's property. are the mosquitoes landing on the structure itself prior to going and searching out the homeowners? And so it's a very complex situation, and whether or not mosquitoes are going to land first on a treated surface, or are they just going to go fly directly onto the individual? It's a difficult proposition sometimes, depending on the setup of the structure and depending on the setup of the neighbors too.
Yeah,
I don't know can you think of another thought on that, Fritter?
Yeah, no, that's right. I mean, some properties are up against the green belt, and you don't have access to those properties, right? So how do you treat for mosquito control? You're going to always have an influx of mosquitoes flying in after a host looking for to feed on people playing in the yard, the kids and all that. So it's really hard. It still is best to have that type of service, because they eventually are going to land somewhere and they will get the product. But it becomes a challenge when you have a lot of conducive conditions near that property and you don't have access to it. So it's a good opportunity to pass your business card to the next door neighbor and try to give them some control. Another new customer.
Especially if they like them. If they don't like them, it might be in trouble. The other thing to do is set expectations, explain, they don't have very much vegetative material to be applying, so they don't have very many surfaces for mosquitoes to land on behaviorally. And so reducing that expectation, hey, I could reduce the mosquitoes, there's no doubt. Can I eliminate them? Probably not, because of your neighbor. But I can definitely reduce them. And then I like, Fredder's idea of trying to spread the business. And if you can spread the business and do the jobs at roughly the same time period, you're gonna have roughly the same results. And so you can have a little bit more consistency within those.
All right, so there are now more open questions that I see. Before we end, I do wanna, once again, I want to thank you for participating today. Remember that I wanna also thank Dr. Myers for his great presentation. Always remember that if you have any questions, you can reach out to the BSF sales reps. And I wanna wish you all the great rest of the week, and please be safe. Thank you.
Take care, everybody.